Hello, my name is Dave Ernst. I'm the Executive Director of the Open Education Network. And I'm just here to say about half a minute worth of words here to introduce this session. This session is about the Open Education Network's faculty workshop and some of the revisions that have taken place. This is an old workshop. This is a workshop that's been around quite a while, and it's been around because it's been very successful, but it's also been around from the time when open education was really primarily about affordability. And the OEN has taken the time and effort to try to update this deck, to update it to reflect the opportunity to talk to faculty about a number of the benefits of open education that branch out beyond affordability. And so that's what you'll be seeing today. You'll hear Tanya Growsz introduce this, and then Meggie Mapes, who will be introduced here soon, is going to actually present the workshop for you. So with that, I pass that on to Tanya.
Thanks, Meggie. Could you advance the deck, please? Thank you. So good morning. I'm Tanya Growsz, and I'm the Director of Educational Programs for the OEN. Before we begin, the OEN is housed at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, which is located on traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of Indigenous people. The university resides on Dakota land ceded in the treaties of 1837 and 1851. We acknowledge this place as a complex and layered history. This land acknowledgement is just one of the ways in which we work to educate the campus and community about this land and our relationships with it and each other. We're committed to ongoing efforts to recognize, support, and advocate for American Indian nations and peoples, and we thank the Dakota people for their persistence through a violent history. Please feel free to acknowledge the Indigenous people to whom the land you are situated on belongs in the chat if you feel so inclined. As mentioned during the summit kickoff on Monday, each of our summit sessions relates back to one of the OEN's strategic planning action pathways. This session relates back to the adoptions pathway. And please feel free as we go along to post questions in the Q&A feature of Zoom. As we begin the session, I'd like to share a few important details with you. This session is being recorded, and for that reason, you have been muted. The video, transcripts, and slides will be sent to all attendees and to the OEN Google group after the summit has concluded. Videos will also be posted on the Community Hub. We are committed to providing a friendly, safe, and welcoming environment for all attendees. You can learn more about our community norms at z.umn.edu/summit-community-norms. Please join us in creating a safe and constructive space. The hashtag for the summit is #OEN Summit22. Join us on Twitter at @OpenEd_network. And I'm posting those things in the chat right now. And then Meggie, if you could advance a couple to the revision overview, please. Thank you. So as Dave mentioned, this faculty deck is foundational to engaging faculty in open education. And we know that 45% of faculty who attend this workshop and review an open textbook in the open textbook library go on to adopt an open textbook. I'd like to briefly highlight some of the changes that we made to this deck. First of all, we tightened it up because we know that people prefer workshops that can be delivered in a 1-hour timeframe. But this version also more explicitly acknowledges issues of inclusion and educational equity by naming them and utilizing examples that demonstrate the power of open education to create more inclusive, equitable learning environments for our students. We also intentionally made the speaker notes more explicit because presenters have asked for that over the years. While we still acknowledge, of course, that presenters still have the ability to customize this deck as they need to. We updated it to reflect that while affordability is still a central concern, the benefits of open education reach far beyond affordability. While our narrative is intact, the problem that which goes to the solution, which goes to benefits, and then what you can do, we feel that this update better reflects the scope of what open education can do. Specifically, we wanted to more clearly illustrate how open education goes hand in hand with equity. And a few ways we did that was by changing the title, more intentionality, including more intentionality around land acknowledgments. We named the problem of students who feel marginalized and left out. We included more explicit speaker notes for those who wish to use them. We included the common questions about open textbook section to address concerns that we often hear around inclusive access. And we provided concrete examples of open textbooks utilized to make learning more culturally relevant and inclusive. As always, we are very open to feedback on the revised deck. If you have any questions, concerns, or feedback, please don't hesitate to email me at growsz045@umn.edu. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Meggie Mapes, a longtime presenter for OEN, who will be presenting this deck to you all today. Meggie is the introductory course director at the University of Kansas and just a lovely person overall. So thank you, Meggie. I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Tanya and Dave. I really, really am super, super happy to be spending today with all of you. And before we sort of jump into the faculty deck itself, I just wanted to give you a little bit of information and context on my end. So first and foremost, there are going to be opportunities for questions at the end. Please go ahead and write those down and we'll be able to address those in the chat. Also, I am going to ask for some feedback with you as we go through the workshop in the chat also. If you're so inclined, I want to thank you in advance for that participation. So like Tanya overviewed, I'm going to spend the next 50 to 60 minutes with you really walking through this new version of the faculty slide deck. And of course, this is mostly about really trying to increase adoptions and increasing awareness and education for faculty about the benefits of open textbooks and open educational resources more generally. And I'm going to do this with you in kind of two ways. Of course, you're going to experience how I would really present the deck to a faculty audience. And I'm also going to try to take some opportunities with you to kind of step back and explain to you why I'm making some of those choices, options or opportunities you have on some of the slide decks so that you can also make this what works for you. So of course, take out of this workshop whatever you need. All of you are going to have different experiences, different commitments to open education, and those are really important parts to infuse to make sure that you're connecting with your actual faculty audience. So before I kind of dive in, I want to give you just a little bit of information about who I am, how I arrived here, both because I think it's important as you listen to me talk at you for the next hour, and also to invite you to really spend time doing this for yourself as you adapt this faculty deck. So like Tanya mentioned, my name is Dr. Meggie Mapes. I am a faculty member in the Department of Communication Studies at the University of Kansas. My title is Introductory Course Director. I like to joke that when I started as an educator, I didn't think I would be spending so much time talking about open textbooks. But my role as an introductory course director really led me here because I'm responsible for making curricular choices for around 25 to 3,500 students every year. I learned really quickly that publishing reps were very invested in spending time with me and trying to persuade me to adopt those books. I quickly realized then that there are so many ethical considerations that we need to place at the forefront when we're making choices about textbooks and other educational resources. The second part of my sort of life as a faculty member is research, and I study pedagogy, and I'm most interested in inclusive pedagogy, critical pedagogy projects. So that is what brings me here a little bit with you today. Now, as you can see on this opening agenda, we're going to spend time really figuring out what problems are we trying to address, what are open textbooks, and then what can we do? So again, taking just a little bit of a step back, you'll notice that the sort of arc, the narrative arc of this presentation is really focused on a problem-solution model that asks faculty members to do something as a form of call to action. So I mention that again because as someone who studies public speaking, I know it can be helpful to think about that overall meta framework and organization for a presentation as you think about what's going to work for you and how you're going to adapt it to meet the needs of your own faculty. Before though we jump into that problem question, I'm going to give you a little bit of an introduction about who the Open Education Network is. So who is in our network and what exactly are our goals? So the Open Education Network is a diverse network of higher education institutions, not a vendor, but instead a community that's really interested in making higher education more affordable, more equitable, and more accessible. So the OEN represents over 1,100 member campuses across the United States, Canada, and Australia. You'll see all of the different kinds of research institutions, colleges, consortia that the Open Education Network really works to make connections with and collaborations. So in order to sort of advance that value around accessible higher education, the OEN really does that through action, collaboration, and the common good, a focus on the common good. The OEN then is focused on action that advances open education in ways that are shareable, collaborative, and sustainable. And I think it's really important to foreground that this is accomplished through community. So the OEN are not disparate members, but really an integrated community with interests based in the same ideals. You might be most familiar, and a great example of one effort to support the common good is the Open Textbook Library. So the OTN is a comprehensive library of open textbooks, a huge archive with books that are reviewed by faculty and that make open textbooks freely available to anyone, anywhere, and at any time. And so while that's just one part of the Open Education Network, their overall kind of goal and value is the advancement of educational equity through resources and practices that are more affordable, more accessible, and more inclusive. And I'm actually just going to put a link to the Open Textbook Library in the chat with you. We'll kind of continue to return to that. I recommend that you put it as a bookmark on one of your browsers. So, and this is really when we think about the OEN's focus on inclusivity, that's what's really key about the faculty workshop, is to learn, to connect, and to really inspire everyone to focus on inclusive educational environments. So a commitment to inclusivity is where the workshop begins for faculty. I like to start the workshop, and I'm going to invite that you do this quick thought experiment with me. If you want to put your answer in the chat, you're absolutely welcome to. I want you to think and ask yourself, what brings you here? And I don't mean here as in the workshop. I mean, what brought you to education? What made you understand education as being the place that you wanted to land for your career, to show up to work every day? If I think about it for myself, I, of course, believe in education. I think education matters, that to provide everyone access to education is meaningful, not just for the advancement of their own life, but really for broader community good, for the reduction of social justice. That's what really gets me up and motivates me every day. And the UN Declaration of Human Rights reflects that commitment, right? Is that higher education should be equally accessible to all. And when I was younger, although I still had that commitment, when I thought about providing access, equitable access to education, I really thought about it as a place, a space. Everyone should be able to have access to a public school. Right? We should be able to provide anyone with the means to advance themselves through education. But I think COVID really spotlighted a lot of additional barriers that can prohibit accessibility. So throughout today, when we talk about access, we're really talking about inclusivity and social justice. This is such an important place to start for the workshop because it brings faculty back into their value system and really, again, reminds us that we are all unified towards that commitment. Yes, I absolutely agree, Michelle, that solving problems in our society is always going to go back to those questions of education. And we need as many people as possible, especially now, working towards that common good. So we all believe in the transformational potential of education, that everyone should have access to inclusive education. But there's a problem. We're not really living up to that promise. So this graph shows us how the burden then of higher education has shifted from the state to the student. If you want to take a look here, you'll notice that that kind of orange line is state funding, and the purple line is tuition. What you're going to notice is, of course, that as soon as state funding is reduced, that that burden becomes more shifted to the student onto those tuition costs. So we know that the financial load for students has doubled. And we can make this more specific even to our own states. I, of course, am at the University of Kansas, and my graph is even more troublesome, right? When we think about how much tuition is having to make up for that reduction in funding. And according to the Institute of College Access and Success, nationally, right, more than 6 in 10 6 in 10 graduating seniors had student loans with an average debt of almost $30,000. And that's just if you actually make it to the end, right? Some people have tremendous amounts of student debt and don't actually have the degree to show for it, right? So unfortunately, these last couple of slides aren't going to surprise many of us because they're experiences that we're having on our own campus as well. We are seeing drastic pay cuts at our institutions. We're doing way, way more with less. I have many colleagues, for example, who aren't sure they will ever get travel or research funds back after COVID cuts. And so while we're experiencing them, this data really reminds us that it is students that are making up the difference, that have devastating consequences, really mainly that we are not able to fulfill the burden of providing access, of providing equitable access. Here's just a little example from my campus. A few years ago, KU joined hundreds of other campuses across the United States and got a food pantry. It's obviously important to be able to provide access of food for students. And I was noticing that that food pantry was being used to market for new students, which is a little bit mind-blowing if you think about it, that we aren't really just recruiting on good education, on what we're doing on campuses, but we're acknowledging that there's a problem, so much so that we have to recruit students by persuading them to come to a campus because they'll have access to a food pantry, right? So this kind of data, these sort of anecdotes are troublesome, right? So when we talk about access to higher education, we have to acknowledge that college is expensive, and that alone makes it really inaccessible for a lot of people. These are kind of five major costs of attendance, major expense categories: tuition and fees, housing, books and supplies, personal expenses, and transportation. If you could in the chat just share with me, what do you think we're going to spend the remainder of our time today talking about? Which of these categories? Yes. Absolutely. It is books and supplies. And that's because it's the category that faculty have the most advocacy over. I've been waiting for someone to knock on my door to ask me what we should do about our tuition crisis. Hopefully someday I'll be able to contribute. But right now, right, as faculty, we know that faculty have the kind of most advocacy over being able to make a change about this expense category. And this is really, really important framing for faculty on your campus, actually, because in my experience, when I was coming up as a new graduate student, making choices about course material, including textbooks, deciding based on a more traditional publishers was just a really normal and natural way to make decisions. I just thought everyone chose very, very expensive textbooks. And so helping faculty really understand that the choices that they're making have important and long-term consequences for students, that that is a really important ethical component is necessary to consider. So I know you're wondering though, you know, what are students really paying for their books? And the federal government, of course, mandates that we have to communicate with students some ideas about mandatory costs of attendance and things like books and supplies. Overall, you'll see here that students are told to budget around $1,200 to $1,400 for books. When I looked up the University of Kansas for this year, we're telling students that they should budget around $1,200. $1,200 is a lot of money for anyone. And what we're noticing, though, is that that's not actually what students are spending. They're only really spending around $400. What do you think is making up the difference? What accounts for the difference between what we're telling students they should budget for and the amount of money they're actually spending? Absolutely, Taylor. They might not be able to actually purchase the book. Are there any other reasons you could think of that might account for that difference? Yes, sharing. Yep, rent, borrow, share, pirate, 100%. And I think this is really, really important because students are savvy and they're making difficult choices, not because they want to, but because the cost is really, really insurmountable. $1,200 is a lot of money for me, right? Much less students. Right? And so they are making those really, really difficult choices. And those are risky choices for many of them, right? Maybe they have to delay purchasing and they miss the first quiz, for example. I like to remind faculty here, in an attempt to sort of reframe some of their experiences, right, that if we acknowledge that textbooks are really, really expensive, that students, when they show up on the first day of class and they might not have the book, that isn't because they are lazy or they don't like you or they're not interested in your class, but actually data really tells us more likely is that they can't actually afford to purchase the book or the course materials that have been assigned in the class. And we know that regardless of how much students are actually spending on course materials, that there is an impact of that cost. We know, of course, that textbook costs affect students financially, but this is one of my favorite pieces of data to show because it explicitly connects that financial barrier or that cost with actual academic success, the impact that that has on the student experience. So in the survey, this is around 21,000 students who participated in a survey done by the Florida Virtual Campus Office of Distance Learning and Student Services. And the survey examined textbook affordability for Florida's public higher education institutions. They were asked, in your academic career, has the cost of the required textbook caused you to? And we might not be surprised, right, especially based on our answers in the chat, to know that 64% indicated, I didn't buy the textbook. I wasn't able to purchase the book. These other responses, though, really help give us insight into the multiple consequences that occur when students are faced with that financial barrier. 17%, right, failing a course, having to withdraw from a course. We have 40% of people who are not registering for a specific class because they're looking up and aren't able to afford those costs. So this survey is really, really key, again, to make that connection between cost and student success explicit as you're making the connection to the problem for faculty audiences. I've also found that this data can be really, really important and persuasive for different values that your faculty is dealing with on campus, including questions of enrollment. We are constantly, every semester, we're talking about our enrollment numbers. And what this data shows us is that the cost of educational resources does affect a student's willingness to register for a class or stay in a class. So again, there are lots of really creative ways that you can work with and persuade audience members to think about the multitude of impacts that affordability barriers have on student success. But there are other educational equity issues outside of affordability that can affect students' academic performance and classroom experience. Because inaccessible classrooms, including inaccessible classroom materials, are overtly exclusive to many student populations, right? So historically in our faculty deck, we spend a lot of important time focusing on this area of the problem, right? That connection between affordability and success. And we're really sort of working with faculty to understand that there are clear inclusivity issues that are also important for us to consider. And that here we're really framing as a sense of belonging in the classroom. So we've talked a little bit about students having to shoulder the burden of tuition costs and textbook costs, but I also want us to consider, for example, the culture of belonging that happens or doesn't happen on campus. This quote is a great one. I'm going to read it with you together. It says, racialized minorities and first-generation students at four-year institutions are less inclined to feel that same sense of belonging compared to their peers at other two-year institutions. Right? And this makes sense, right? Students who have access to the rules of the game, who know the hidden curriculum, oftentimes they aren't first-generation college students. They're students who are legacy or have individuals who are able to kind of help describe that hidden curriculum to them. That means, where can I borrow a textbook? Who do I ask for if I need assistance? Even that ability to translate a syllabus and course calendar to see when a textbook or course materials may be used for effective planning. All of those contribute to a sense of belonging. And students without that knowledge fail to be included, which can and does have short and long-term consequences, right? These students may feel like they aren't being seen in the classroom. And we have evidence, right, that marginalized folks have difficulty succeeding in college. It's important for us to really ask ourselves how educational materials are so central to the kind of culture that we're creating for all different types of diverse students. So the problem, when we think about this overall problem, is there a financial barrier? Absolutely. Does that barrier clearly reduce student success and academic achievement? 100%. And we want to investigate the kind of educational legacy and flexibility that traditional educational resources provide versus other opportunities to make sure that we're foregrounding that kind of sense of belonging and inclusivity constantly, right? And so this is where we're sort of going to transition from the problem with faculty to the solution. One thing though, before I make that a transition, as you begin to sort of develop the problem for yourself, I really strongly encourage you to think about integrating anecdotes and stories of some of those firsthand experiences that all of you have had with students on campus and the way that they're continuing to struggle because of a multitude of barriers. Right? So again, lots and lots of problems that we want to place at the forefront. And luckily, of course, we have one solution for faculty members that we want them to consider. So as we consider affordability, access, lack of diversity in the curriculum, and whose knowledge is valued in education, we're going to think about open textbooks as one way to address. And I say one way to address specifically, right? We are absolutely not proposing that open textbooks are a magical wand where every kind of exclusive practices within higher education are going to be solved or resolved. We would love that. I would love it. But of course, that's not what we're suggesting. Instead, we're really trying to foreground open textbooks and open educational resources overall as a tool that you can put in your resource box to address educational equity. So, if you aren't familiar, right, what are open textbooks? Open textbooks are one type of open educational resource, one solution that are a material that are licensed to be free forever, and they need to be downloaded only once to be used freely thereafter, right? And so thank you, it's really sweet in the chat. As we think about what open textbooks are, a really important part to introduce open textbooks is to help faculty understand that there are already models that exist that lead to the successful creation of open textbooks. And it can be helpful to help them understand that here's the kind of traditional publishing model. So here on the left represents how we really assume all publishing happens. And I'll speak really from my first person experience. I had almost no information about what happened behind the curtain in terms of publishing textbooks. I assumed everything happened this way. And so what we know is in this traditional model, a publisher invests in publishing a textbook. Students buy that book. The funds, of course, go back to the publisher. And the publisher pays a royalty to the author, usually a very, very, very small single digit percentage, right? But of course, there's another way, there's another model. And that is, instead of having a traditional publisher, you have a college or university publish the book, right? And as part of that process, it's common now for those institutions to pay faculty upfront for their efforts. This is important because many people that I talk to have this idea that the only way open textbooks happen is just by a lone faculty member being unsupported in their basement, you know, writing a book all summer long, right? Instead, what we're seeing is that there are lots of really important structures that are already in place through colleges or universities in order to reward faculty for their time. Because like I said earlier, we know that faculty and staff are overworked. So that ability to pay faculty upfront is really, really important. Earlier in this model, the development of this model, there were foundations or government consortia that were funding open textbooks. But more and more, we're really seeing that colleges and universities are taking over as a kind of main organizing factor. So of course, this model allows textbooks to be free and available, freely shared and copied. This slide in my experience here has been the most educational for faculty because faculty don't know what we don't know, right? So just having comfort or knowing that on their own universities, on their own campuses, there may be already, of course, usually in amazing libraries, people who are supporting these efforts. Now, just note here that the publishing process can look exactly the same in both of these models. So there can still be peer review, there can still be copy editing, for example. I actually authored an open textbook and had so much support provided to me for the University of Kansas Libraries. And it's possible then to publish a free textbook while also really respecting the efforts of that author. And this more open model also has the potential of addressing inequalities in traditional publishing model. Whose stories are told? Who gets to tell those stories? Often you're going to have much more editorial control on that model on the right. And this is so significant right now in a time when we have growing legislation and bans from educators about what we can and cannot talk about. Most of those are focused on social justice, right? Critical race theory is one example. And traditional textbook publishers are feeling the pressure to bend to those bans, right? So this has led to some books published by major publishers trying to focus only on certain stories or historical narratives that dilute the content, right? So a more open publishing model invites more players into the process and broadens that gatekeeping process in a much more democratic way. And Lisa has mentioned in the chat, unfortunately, yes, not all universities do provide funding. I will say I've been noticing in my discipline a lot more cross-institutional collaboration. So being able to do some information sharing and asking what institutions do have funding that can assist in supporting multiple collaborative authors and trying to get that work off the ground. But fingers crossed that more institutions will continue to find ways to support authors in that process. So this open model is really, really has so much potential. And the reason that this slide is important is that it addresses the assumption that to get a free textbook, someone must have volunteered to write it, or the publishing process must be worse, which is in fact not necessarily the case. But there's one more thing that comes into play when we think about both of these models. So, it's copyright, right? Think about a faculty member having to, for example, assign just one book chapter in their course. Technically, right, copyright means that they should pay a fee in order to get permission, which would grant them a license in order to make copies of that chapter to distribute to students in order to read. And of course, the model on the left here really requires copyright because it wouldn't work if copyright protections didn't exist. If, for example, there weren't copyright protections, it means that that the publisher could sell one copy that students could then copy and distribute amongst themselves. So copyright is what mandates that each individual student have to purchase their own individual book because of that license. So copyright is still a really important part of the conversation when we're thinking about this model on the right, when we're thinking about open textbooks. And the model on the right also has copyright, right? But it's different because remember that in that open model, our intention is to make content be freely available so that it can be copied, shared, that a student can keep that information forever. So copyright as it's traditionally understood isn't necessarily sufficient. So to give instructors and students the intended rights to communicate with them what the author feels okay with them to do, we need the publisher to give the textbook a license that allows users to do those things. So we know, of course, that copyright law is extremely, extremely important, but it has limitations. It wasn't intended to help people do a core goal of open, which is to share. So instead, we need Creative Commons. And Creative Commons is a nonprofit that creates licenses to help people who want to share copyrightable intellectual property, right? So just to clarify, right, open doesn't mean that the author has no rights over what they want done with that content. Instead, Creative Commons really allows authors who are writing or who are adopting clear guidelines about what is available for them to do with that content or what isn't. So CC, Creative Commons, as some rights reserved, it's a license on top of copyright. And it means that the creator of the work intends the work to be freely used, freely shared, and sometimes freely edited or remixed. So if we go back to this publishing model, right, we have the college, still, or university working with an author to create the book. We have, we still need that kind of Creative Commons license as the last piece of the puzzle to make sense of this model. Now, here's just a quick note to be transparent. I am not a copyright expert. I actually remember the first time I watched Dave do this presentation, and I thought I was horrified about the idea that a faculty member was going to ask me a complicated question about copyright, and I would fall on my face, right? And you might not be a copyright expert either, that is okay. I think while it can feel like a barrier, if we feel a little bit unsure about copyright language, it can actually be a really great opportunity here when you're talking with faculty members, because many, many campuses have resources or ScholarCom librarians who are the person that we can direct faculty members to in order to make sure that they get those questions answered. So remember, part of our goal in our workshop is to recenter that sense of community and encourage faculty to utilize the resources at their disposal, both as an OEN member and as a member of their own campus community. It can be really, really important, I think, to address that concern, because faculty members may, as they listen to this presentation with you, feel a sense of anxiety about copyright, feel a little bit insecure about being able to read Creative Commons licenses, be able to make choices if they are interested not only in adopting, but also in writing. So you want a foreground. We understand that you are not a copyright expert. Let's try to encourage you to get connected with people who can answer those questions and make them feel a lot more credible about making those copyright choices. So again, Creative Commons is a really important last piece of this puzzle. And under the kind of Creative Commons licenses, there are these four different components. I'll talk you through each of them briefly. So the one on the left is by, it means attribution. And all that means is that that textbook author wants you to know that you can do what you'd like with the book, but you want to make sure that you give them credit, right? That means giving them credit. I'm not sure why I'm making that more complicated, right? So just attribution. The second is NC, which means non-commercial. This means that if you use someone else's open textbook in your class, you can't charge every student a dollar. Right. So again, it's just making sure and communicating, hey, we want to make sure that this content remains open and remains free so other people can't use it and put a price tag on it. The third is SA, and it's called share alike. What that means is if you would do something else with the work, if you would edit it or remix it, that author wants to make sure that you use the same CC license that they have on their original work. And the last is ND, which is no derivative. It's the most restrictive of the four licenses in my experience. The author is telling you, hey, you can share, you can copy, you can keep it forever, but I'm not comfortable with you making a derivative of this work. I'm not comfortable with you editing or remixing it, for example. Okay. So when we think about these four licenses, they can kind of combine and we can adjust them into these six. And this is the way, of course, that the CC license is going to be communicated with faculty. So it's important to think about what they mean. So I'm going to quiz you briefly as a good educator, right? In my experience, a very, very common educational resource that's integrated into classrooms is TED Talks. Right? They're great. If you had to guess, or if you're familiar, do you have any idea which of these is the most commonly used for a CC TED Talk? Okay, the first one, definitely by is part of it. TED Talks also are going to ask you to be a little bit more restrictive. Yep. Actually, yes, it's actually correct. It is this last one, the very bottom right. Right. So TED Talk, they're fine with you using the work for free, keeping it, downloading it forever. Right. But they want to make sure when you do it, you're giving credit, that you can't charge against students, and they don't want you to create a derivative. Usually they don't want you remixing or doing anything else with their kind of TED Talk. So again, just being able to have some kind of language around these different licensees can be really, really important to make faculty feel more comfortable, even as they're making choices about how they want to integrate materials into their own classes. So when we think about Creative Commons, we're thinking about the ability to copy, to share, to edit, to mix, to keep or use, or some variation of these, right? Any CC license is going to allow you, again, to share it, to keep it, to use it, to copy it. And some of them also are really going to allow you to edit it, to remix it alone or with other different open resources. Okay, so open then means free plus permissions. This is where that transition from understanding open as merely free to really understanding the important permissions or licenses that are possible helps us gain complexity into not just open as reducing affordability barriers, but how open practices can address other issues related to creating inclusive curriculum, for example, making curriculum or editing it in ways that speak to the specific needs of a student population. Because when we enable users to engage with the content in many ways, especially through these licensing, we get closer at achieving more equitable learning outcomes. So, after hundreds of workshops that the OEN has given, it's been clear that there are some kind of common and core questions that are about open textbooks. And I'm going to kind of address some of those briefly with you here. Now, I know each of you are absolutely going to be taking this slide deck and doing many presentations, but even if you aren't yet ready, these are questions that you absolutely will get from faculty, even as you're working with them in their own one-on-one basis. So it's important, even if you never hold a faculty workshop, again, I know you will, that you consider how you want to answer these in your own open advocacy work. Right. And so, you know, please kind of think about my answers, think about how you might adjust them also as you work and begin to work with faculty. So the first is very, very common. Where do we find books? Right. The best place we're going to direct faculty to is the Open Textbook Library. Right. The Open Textbook Library, as I previewed earlier, is the most comprehensive catalog of open textbooks. And more importantly, even, that it includes faculty reviews of about two-thirds of the textbooks in this collection. This might sound strange, and it's exactly why I recommend bookmarking this. It's because the biggest question that I get is, how do I find an open textbook, right? Again, we're used to kind of having, I'm used to, in my experience as a faculty member, I'm used to getting textbook recommendations from other colleagues. Mostly though, I'm used to getting contacted by publishing reps. They're doing that work of information sharing for me. So we need to make sure that we're kind of making the effort to direct faculty members just to take a look. So not only even if they don't find a book that they will utilize for classes that they have now, that they're aware of the huge repository of different textbooks that are available to them the next time they're going to do a curricular redesign in a course of their choice. So where do we find them? Open Textbook Library. The second question is, are they any good? This is a question that also I get all the time. Again, there's a lot of myths related to what open textbooks look like and that process. Okay? So you can see here that the Open Textbook Library collects reviews, and this is the kind of results of those Open Textbook Library reviews. We see a lot of, for example, 4.5 to 5-star ratings on the textbooks. And the OEN does not request good reviews. It really does ask for honest reviews. There's no OEN member behind the curtain who is editing all of the reviews to make sure that the books, you know, look better than they may actually be, right? So these are honest reviews. And it's also a reason why it can be really, really important to direct faculty members to look at the Open Textbook Library themselves, because not only will they see the kind of sheer volume of open textbooks that are available, they're able to go to textbooks that are in their discipline and look at both the quantitative and qualitative feedback that their disciplinary peers have provided on textbooks of their choice. Another great answer to this is just go ahead and take a look for yourself. We would never say that every single textbook using the traditional publishing model is the best book ever written, right? And so the invitation again for faculty to take a good look is the kind of best answer to the question, are there any good? Because it reaffirms faculty members as credible as the decision makers and as capable of making the choice and the book selection, the book adoption process that's best for the needs of their students. There are also examples of open textbooks that have won textbook awards. This one, the Blueprint for Success in College and Career, won the Textbook and Academic Author Association. And this wasn't just against other open textbooks. This was against books who are also using that traditional publisher model. But beyond where you can find the books and beyond these kind of questions of quality, We are also asked if there's a correlation between open textbooks and academic achievement. So you might remember from the kind of problem components of the workshop, we had that really great yet troublesome data that showed us students had reported they'd made some choices like dropping the class or they had to fail a class because of the cost of the book. But now we actually have evidence that indicates that there is a correlation between the adoption of an open textbook and academic achievement. So this is another one of my favorite slides. Even though I'm a qualitative researcher, I love the data in a couple of these slides that's presented. So this shows the results of a large-scale study, almost 22,000 students, regarding the impact of course-level faculty adoptions of open educational resources. So this data is so interesting. What it looked at, of course, is what was the change in grades and in drop, fail, withdrawal rates, which is what DFW stands for, drop, fail, withdraw. What was that change when a faculty member moved from a non-OER to an actual OER? Of course, then these results are astounding. If you look at the all students at the very bottom here, we can see that there was over an 8.5 increase in grades, and there was a reduction of 2.5 percentage points in drop, fail, withdraw. Right? That is that's astounding. And also, it doesn't surprise me, right? If we know that students aren't able to buy the book, they're having to make other difficult choices about access, we know that means they aren't able to participate in the economy of knowledge that's happening in the classroom. So when you guarantee that students are able to have access to the resources that they need to succeed in the class, and access to the kind of terminology that you're going to be testing them on, that they'll be discussing in class, that they not only have an increase in that grade, but it also means they're staying in the class longer, right? They're not dropping the class. They're not withdrawing from the class, right? Which again, speaks to not only that connection to academic success, it also speaks to that question of belonging, right? And helping keep the most marginalized students in our classrooms. You'll notice, for example, that while all students had a higher grade and a lower drop, fail, withdraw, that Pell eligible students in particular, that second line there, saw a substantial increase in their grade, almost 11%, and saw almost 4.5 percentage point reduction in their likelihood that there will be a drop, fail, or withdrawal from the class. So not having money to buy course materials makes a difference. Having immediate free and forever access to course materials makes a difference. But we need to be careful, however, not to conflate open with other types of affordability initiatives. And a very, very common question we get is about inclusive access being the same as OER. If you aren't familiar, inclusive access is one option on the spectrum of affordability course materials. There are some, but there are better low-cost alternatives or zero-cost alternatives to students. So open educational resources have the advantage of customizability, perpetual use, and unlimited free access. So library licensed materials have the advantage of free access, but only as long as a student is enrolled, which is often what inclusive access means. You can have access to your course materials, often bundled in a student fee. But as soon as you are done being enrolled at the university, you're gonna lose access. Just think about that from a disciplinary perspective. We enter our disciplines, we care about the content that students are going to receive. For me anyway, I think that it's important for them to consider and have access to that material for forever, not just to succeed in their major, though that's important, but to succeed when they leave. And many of these initiatives or traditional publishing models that are requiring access codes restrict that student access as soon as they're no longer in your class, as soon as they're no longer enrolled. And if you want to learn more about inclusive access programs, on the bottom of this slide here, which you'll have access to, you can click on and check out the 9 questions OpenStax would have you ask about inclusive access, access programs. So when we think again back to what are the main questions we're getting, where do we look? Are there any good? Is inclusive access the same? And a final, also very, very popular question you'll get is, are there any ancillary materials? And just like commercial textbooks, some do and some don't. here are some examples of places to find ancillary materials. The OpenStax Hub, for example, my Open Math. And I wanna lead by saying, I absolutely understand this question. I understand the centrality and importance that having access to instructor materials can mean, especially for contingent faculty members. So it's important that we really take seriously that those adjunct faculty members in particular are also having to make difficult choices because of our resource shortages. Right? I do think though, when we're asked this question, that it can be a barrier. Of course, not all open textbooks have ancillary materials, but it can also be a great opportunity. In my department, for example, we decided to adopt an OER, an open textbook for our business communication class, and there were no ancillaries. Instead, we recruited support from our department chair, and we used it as an opportunity to work with GTAs on pedagogy, on creating instructor resources. So they made them, right? So they created a whole base of instructor resources. Okay. So again, the answer is there may be ancillary materials, and the OTL Open Textbook Library does show when those supplemental instructor materials are not. But again, there may be other ways to think creatively about collaborations to try to get additional resources where there are gaps in ancillaries. Now, those are some of the kind of core questions, but there are some other really, really cool ways that Open really allows improving student success. So in this kind of section of the workshop, we're gonna answer the question, how else can open textbooks improve student success? Again, we're really interested in thinking about this question of inclusivity and students who are at the most risk of dropping out. Remember, they need to see themselves as belonging in the school. They might feel like an imposter, and even small barriers can cause them to leave school. I always really try to tell faculty, and even for myself, as I think about Open, I try to help faculty understand that, you know, educational resources, our textbooks, is not additive to the college experience, that it is fundamental in contributing to the culture and environment that can either include or exclude certain student populations. So let's take a look at some of the ways that open textbooks might help remove some additional barriers and help them make them feel that they belong. Here are four ways. And for me, these next few slides are really where we see a focus on inclusivity, because at a base level, Open asks us to consider fundamental questions about the nature of our educational resources. What is working and what isn't? What have we taken for granted in our business as usual approach to educational resources? Who is empowered or disempowered in that approach? And how does Open enable new potential pathways for students and for instructor training on pedagogy? So there are kind of four things we'll talk about here. The ability to customize the curriculum, content customization, contextualizing the curriculum, making it more inclusive, and by providing opportunities for innovative pedagogy. So to begin, content customization. I'm gonna nerd out here with you all a little bit, because this is where I started to learn just how cool Open really is, right? So on the left here, we'll see an Open textbook that's for a low level statistics course. Right? Now, the right is a derivative of the book on the left, and it includes content specific to learning statistics with a spreadsheet. So functionally what happened is the authors on the right realized, oh wow, there are so many very, very cool things in this collaborative statistics textbook that is working for us, but the examples and the focus aren't on using spreadsheets to learn statistics. So that customization then enables them to take what they need while making it specific, embedding examples that meet not only the needs of their students, but the specific learning outcomes that they're required to teach in those courses. Right. So again, I love this as well, because it helps faculty understand that, hey, creating or editing, remixing an open book does not mean that you have to start from scratch. There are so many open textbooks with such amazing authors, really, really great ideas. It doesn't mean, though, that every single thing in that book is going to meet the needs or speak to the experiences of the specificity of your students. So open means you can say, wow, there's 75% of terms, of framing, of research in this book that I love, but I really need to mess with 25% of it to meet the specific needs. Even for me, when I talk about content customization with faculty, I also encourage them to think about customization as integrating different open books for the same course. Because remember, with open, you're no longer bound, as I used to feel as a faculty member, to adopt just one book, even if it didn't really meet my needs because it was super expensive. Because you're no longer bound to having cost be such a core component of your decision-making, it means that you're able to go to the open textbook library and think about integrating chapters from different open textbooks that are useful for you. So in communication studies, we're really interdisciplinary. So I've used chapters on information literacy, on critical thinking, on social justice through the open textbook library. So content customization, one really great way that we can, again, try to encourage student success. The second is content contextualization. And here's an example. This is an OpenStax Introduction to Sociology book. Excellent. The right is an Introduction to Sociology, which is the second Canadian edition. If you could in the chat, just share with me, can you think of what might be different between the Introduction to Sociology that is the Canadian edition? Why would it be really important for that faculty member to say, maybe we need to do some contextualization changes? Any ideas? Absolutely. Spelling, language, yes. So of course, sociology, when we think about the study of culture, right, the need to contextualize that as it relates to Canadian culture. These are great examples, being bilingual, for example, right? So being able to take important information, again, studies, information from that Introduction to Sociology book, and contextualize it so that it speaks to the student experience. It's strange, right? Canadian students shouldn't have to learn sociology that's based in a US context. So this addition allows students to learn within a context that they're familiar with. Next is this idea of inclusion. So diversifying and amplifying voices, right? So open education can also empower inclusion by diversifying underserved voices. And these next two examples are really going to highlight how scientists and anthropologists notice that kind of current textbooks excluded really important and core curricular examples. Remember when a little bit earlier when I was talking about the two models, right? Some of the pressure that publishers are feeling to be real information gatekeepers based on calls to be restrictive in censor education. Many of those censorship gatekeeping components aren't going to be required of you if we use that open model. So this openly licensed book, Knowing Home, modified a science book with rich Indigenous examples and used an overarching theme of the braid. So the book provides a window into the vast storehouse of innovations and technologies of the Indigenous people who live in the Northwestern North America. And the editors were really hoping that Indigenous science examples could inspire deeper reflection regarding the underrepresentation of Aboriginal students in the sciences, right? It's important that we have students who can participate in curricular materials with examples of with people, histories of cultural backgrounds similar to their own. And as this next book illustrates, open education can be inclusive by acknowledging and addressing disparities and inequities. So Explorations, an Open Invitation to Biological Anthropology, is an open textbook that was created with 41 authors who had a range of specialists with diverse backgrounds, experiences, gender, and gender, ethnicities, and perspectives. And cross-cultural collaboration was such a core part of creating this open textbook. So the authors were motivated to create a learning resource that supports the goal of social justice in higher education by really foregrounding their own perspective and trying to imbue a real commitment to respecting others' cultural behaviors and worldviews. Right? So again, thinking about that new open model as a way to have ownership over inclusive content creation for students. And finally, I'm going to provide an example of open pedagogy as an example of how textbooks can be used to produce innovative pedagogy. So open pedagogy is a model where faculty engage students as co-creators in knowledge and curriculum. And this is one example. This book is called An Ecological Approach to Obesity and Eating Disorders. And what happened is that students worked with faculty to write the book. Right? So they divided the chapters based on the five levels of an ecological model. And in addition to writing their own individual chapters, they did peer review of all chapters sort of and provided feedback. So open pedagogy is such a really, really interesting and emerging area of open education because it really, really takes seriously that students are contributors to their educational experience. And that not only are they contributors to their educational experience, but that the process of working on educational resources can really advance their critical thinking and engage with that content. It of course means if they're able to write into that experience, their own experiences, that inherently means the inclusion of diversity, different experiences within that those open pedagogical projects. And it means the creation of resources for other instructors that might be able to use that open material in their own classes. So I'll be working on my first bigger open pedagogy project this semester, this fall with graduate students. And I'm really, really looking forward to their feedback. And I'm really looking forward to see how they challenge me and some of our own public speaking curriculum based on their experiences. Robin DeRosa really here sums up the benefits of open textbooks when she says, quote, "Open textbooks save money, which matters deeply to our students, but they can also create a new relationship between learners and course content. And if teachers choose to acknowledge and enable this, it can have a profound effect on the whole fabric of the course." Now, we have really kind of worked then in this part of the workshop to help faculty understand not just why open is helpful in reducing financial barriers, but all of the other very, very cool ways that open means that faculty and students can engage with concepts, especially around commitments and values of inclusivity. This last part then is this kind of call to action, right? We don't just want faculty to have this information in their brains. We really want to direct them where they can use that energy. And that's a kind of what can we do, right? What are some next steps? And here they are. We invite faculty to, of course, take a look. See what is in the open textbook library already. There may be already something there that would work for a course that you're developing. So consider taking a look, consider adopting. The second is we want faculty to write a review. We know statistically that faculty members are more likely to adopt if they're engaging with an actual review. So we want them to write a review, not just so that they'll consider adoption, but also because that's such an important service to other faculty members who are going to go to the open textbook library and look for themselves. So take a look, write a review, consider adoption if it meets the needs of you and your students. And also help remind faculty, hey, we understand if you're not in the cycle to be changing the curriculum now, but we want you to still sort of take a look and keep it in your wheelhouse for the next time that you have time and that you're able to make some of those changes. Another sort of call to action is we want them to raise awareness, right? We want them to talk to colleagues in their programs and in their departments. I often tell faculty, they'll say, oh, I feel a little bit anxious about that ask. I'll say, hey, I suggest in a faculty meeting, just sharing the open textbook library. Again, just helping again other faculty know that there is already an archive or a place in mind that has those books that they can go ahead and review. When we think then about writing a review, right, we want them to take a look and see if there is a textbook in the open library that fits their area of expertise. If you're able, right, it's great if you can provide an incentive for faculty. So make sure, you know, to only promise that incentive if you are able to provide them with a stipend. So if you're able to, then that means that they'll be incentivized both to attend the workshop, this faculty workshop, and incentivized to review a textbook in the open textbook library. So attend, review, and have that stipend or incentive available for them to reward them along those efforts. And here's the process, right? Just communicating with them. That you'll have a link with an online review form. You're going to locate a textbook in an area of expertise for you. Typically, you have about 6 weeks after the workshop in order to complete that review. Although, you know, make sure that you have clarity when you'd like that review finished, when you make that ask for faculty members. So even ask them, you know, what due date works for them, right? Sometimes it can be tricky depending on where you're at in the semester. And note that the review will also have its own open license so that we can share their wisdom about the open textbook or with other open textbook projects. So again, the review will be posted on the open textbook library and the incentive will be paid. Okay. So you move right from really helping them understand all of those problems to considering how open can be an important solution. And then that call to action, really getting them toward engagement with an open textbook through looking, through reviewing, and hopefully, fingers crossed, through adopting and engaging with other faculty colleagues that they have in their department and on campus. And voila, that is the end of the kind of new faculty deck. So I'm gonna pass it back over to Tanya. With an invitation for any questions or ideas that you have.
So thank you everyone for joining us today. Thank you so much, Meggie, for giving the deck so brilliantly. Thank you for joining us as we think about our action pathways. As we move forward with building out each pathway, we invite you to share related projects that you may be working on or ideas that the related summit session sparked for you on the summit community share document. So I'm going to put the deck in the chat in case you don't have that. And then the OER Adoptions Pathway Community document. And we, of course, encourage you to keep the conversation going on as well in the OEN Google group. We want to remind you that today's session has been recorded and will be shared with you via email and posted on the Community Hub in the coming weeks. Slides and transcripts will also be linked. And now I will open it up to questions, either in the chat or the Q&A, and Meggie and Dave and anyone can go ahead and jump in. Okay, so Michelle says, do you recommend addressing free-to-use materials through the libraries in a workshop like this? Sometimes I find it's a good opening to OER, especially for subjects where there aren't a lot of OER available. I will take a stab at this, and then Dave and Meggie, feel free to jump in, but I think it's always helpful to point out the resources already at the student's disposal. And librarians are like our best advocates and allies, and oftentimes the ones doing this open work at these institutions. So I think anything we can do to partner with them and to point out those resources that are already paid for by their tuition, the better. So we typically do mention library resource materials.
I retweet. I don't think I have much to add there. I completely agree, Tanya. And it's a great question, Michelle. I think absolutely making sure, again, those faculty members are aware of those on campus and library resources always.
There's a great question in the Q&A. I was quite struck by the slide that discusses inclusive access when Meggie talked about the problem of students losing access after graduation or course completion when the book is available from the library. For context, I'm a librarian at a private college. I strongly encourage faculty to consider open textbooks first, but when they aren't able to find anything suitable, I feel good when the library can purchase unlimited online access. Would you please talk more about this? I'm very interested in your thoughts. I'll just provide a contextualizing comment about this, and then I don't know, Meggie, Dave, or any of our team has any opinions. I think Dave has done an excellent job over the years of modeling that we don't want to demonize anyone or any product or anything, knowing that faculty might have very close relationships with publishers. Perhaps inclusive access is the best option for them after all these things. Perhaps nothing else was available. So I think that's why why we're careful in our language to posit or position open educational resources as one option in a toolkit among many others, while also pointing out that open has benefits that these other things don't have. So that's just my little contextual thing. As far as actually addressing it, I'm not sure if anyone has anything else that you'd like to say.
Yeah, I'd just add, thanks for that. I would just add that, you know, anything we can do for students is a good thing. And so the question about library license material, and then this one about, you know, you're proud that feel good when the library can purchase unlimited, you should feel good. That's really great. And again, anything we can do for students is awesome. The focus of this workshop and the focus of, you know, what the OEN community is doing is open. And so we don't talk a lot about those things, but it doesn't mean we don't think they're good or we don't think they're good strategies. They definitely are. Anything we can do for students is good. So kudos to you and your libraries for doing those things.
Thank you, Jennifer, for sharing that resource. Any other questions for any of us or in general? Good question, Michelle. Do you have a 2-minute elevator speech on why faculty should do this? I think, okay, so my speech will always, when I started out way long time ago, it was on affordability. It has, my elevator speech has migrated to, it empowers you to teach better. Like it empowers me to be a better educator, a better lit teacher, because I have more choices and I can contextualize and be more inclusive in my learning materials through the power of Creative Commons licensing. So that's mine has migrated, which is sort of interesting. Meggie, Dave, anyone else?
The more you know about who you're giving the elevator pitch to is really, really helpful. So I think, again, to state something that we know is factually true, which is your students are having financial difficulties. So you're eliminating that barrier. And not only that is, in my experience, it has helped me on day one really develop trust with students. Because when I talk about my open textbook, I also talk about why I've made that choice. So they know from day one that I care about their well-being. And I've gotten lots and lots of really great feedback from students about thanking me and about feeling much more connected because I already had students at the forefront before I began the semester. So, and also, yes, everything Tanya said regarding just better teaching, more inclusive teaching, but also you're going to get more students. Students are going to trust you, and that will have long-term implications for your experience in the class.
Any final questions before we wrap up this session for today? Absolutely. And one thing that we've done in the past and might do in the future is have students speaking for themselves. The idea of a textbook video where you have students speaking about not only how textbook costs affected them, but what open resources were like for them. Anytime you can get other faculty to talk about the power of open or students themselves, that's a fabulous strategy. So thank you for that, Jennifer. Okay, well, thank you so much for joining us today. And thank you again, Meggie, for doing such a beautiful job.